Dr. Sara Seager is currently a professor of planetary science, professor of physics, and the class of 1941 professor chair at MIT. She is known particularly for her foundational ideas on exoplanet research, which helped define the field and includes work that led to the first detection of an exoplanet atmosphere. Thank you so much for being here today. So when you began graduate studies at Harvard, the field of exoplanets was still met with skepticism within the scientific community. So despite the uncertainty surrounding the discipline, what motivated you to persist and pursue a career in this emerging field?
Well, that is a great question, but let's back up a little bit. When I started at graduate school in the fall of 1994, that was a very long time ago, there were no known exoplanets at all, no known exoplanets around sun-like stars. So it wasn't just that there was skepticism, there was nothing. But I was finishing a project, and it was time for me to start my PhD. And it was around that time that the first exoplanets around sun-like stars were discovered. And my thesis advisor suggested I work on these new planets. But to answer your question, there's two separate answers. One of that is I was always a risk taker. I think people sometimes don't realize how important taking risks is, whether it's in anything, really. But in this case, I always loved adventure and exploration, and so it was definitely the right project for me. That might have been the answer you expected. But a second, equally important answer that you probably didn't expect was I was not happy in graduate school. I actually didn't even know if I was going to stick it out and finish my PhD. So I had nothing to lose. So in some ways, that was a winning combination. I'm a risk taker, and I like new things and exploring. But at the same time, I realized that I just had nothing to lose because I wasn't trying to check the boxes and get to my next step the way so many people feel like they're forced to do.
I think the second part is very interesting in a way. I think, is it because that you went to graduate school, but you started with pre-med in your undergrad and then shifted to astrophysics?
Well, there's a lot wrapped up in here, but I think it's worth unpacking because of the role model theme of our conversation. So the first point was my dad, who I adored, wanted me to be a doctor. But I, you know, when I found out I could be an astronomer for a job, it was honestly one of the best days of my entire life. I was so excited about this. I just didn't know that that kind of job existed. But when I went back and told my dad about this, he was not happy about it, actually. And he had a really, like, a kind of iconic response. He said, "Sara, you have to get a job and support yourself and not rely on any man." And he was angry that I would consider anything where he thought I couldn't get a job. And I think this story, or this family desire, will be familiar to a lot of you. And I really wanted to do what my dad wanted me to do. In fact, he had it all planned out. He said I could be a dermatologist, because very few people die in that line of medicine. And I could make a lot of money, and I could work part-time and have enough time for a family. And it's a great job. I remember taking my own kids, who are now grown up, to the dermatologist. And this dermatologist would spend like 2 minutes with us. You know, the assistant would do all the work, and she would pop in for 2 minutes and leave. It's like, wow, I mean, what kind of job is that? She's making a ton of money. Great job. So my pre-med was, it didn't last long, but I did it because I wanted to do what my dad said. And it takes a lot to go against your culture. It really takes a lot of effort. When I was unhappy in grad school, my dad still wanted me to be a doctor. But I can tell you why I was unhappy. You know, this is a problem for a lot of people in high school right now, because I see you checking boxes. I have to do this course. I have to get this grade. And you feel good. You get a good grade. You feel good. You finish your homework. You feel good. I'm not happy with that part either. But it kind of leads to this, like in graduate school, you don't have constant homework. You don't have constant tests. You don't have constant feedback. In fact, you have no feedback. And so I went a long time just kind of not having feedback, not really succeeding. I didn't have the skills I needed to really excel, which is computer programming. And it was also my first time away from home. You know, I went to my undergraduate. I lived at home and just, I had my friends that I had in high school and my dad who I saw on weekends, like I still had all that same thing. So I think leaving home for the first time, not having the skill I needed to succeed quickly, and not getting any positive feedback for a very long time. I think all those three things together made it really hard.
Coming back to the point of, you know, you encountering the challenge of navigating your own aspirations amidst your father's different expectations for you. So based on that, do you believe individuals should balance the influence of others' expectations for them with the pursuit of their own goals and passions?
I think everyone should pursue their dreams, but only if you can support yourself and, as my dad said, not rely on any man. So at one point I realized if I can pay for myself, like I don't have to rely on my dad to pay the bill, surely that means I should be able to do my own thing, right? And in the United States anyway, in graduate school, you're given a small stipend so that you can rent an apartment and pay for your groceries. So once you hit graduate school, you can be self-sufficient. I was also taught when I was in school, even from undergraduate physics, that you will get a job. It might not be in the thing you wanted to, but trained in the STEM hard sciences, there are plenty of jobs out there and you'll always be employable. So that was very reassuring. It wasn't so much for risk, really. I might not end up working on exoplanets, but I would knew I would get a good job somewhere. So as soon as I clued into that fact, I was definitely ready to go against my family's wishes. But honestly, there are many, many people out there in the world who have huge regrets. You know, there are much older people than me out there with just essentially a lifetime of regret. So I do encourage everyone to pursue their own dreams as long as you can support yourself.
I think a very important point you made there is financial independence, how at any time it's very important to be able to sustain yourself despite what you're doing. If you can sustain yourself, you can pursue whatever you wish to.
Like I once met this person, he was a family friend and I had to give him a drive. Like it was a pretty long car ride. And he was an author. He wrote books and he loved writing books. But he actually was a physicist, okay, for like 20 years. And he slowly like changed careers, which was good because it's very hard to start out as a writer and make enough money to get by, especially if you want to support a family. So sometimes people have to start out in one thing. Like one young person recently reached out to me desperate for some advice. This young man only realized in his fourth year of university when he was about to graduate that he loved space and might want to be an astronomer for his job. Meanwhile, he had already started his own business and now had a job offer, an incredibly lucrative job in New York City. And I think he knew what the right choice was. Go back to school for 4 years and try to become an astronomer, or take the job that pays well, save up money, and then later try to go back to be grad school. What was the second one? He didn't need me to validate it because I agreed with him. And if he was my son, I'd say take the job. And I gave him a strategy on how to, while doing his new job, try to get knowledgeable in astronomy and network with people in the city he'll be living and go to talks and try to do a project on the side. Like I helped him with a strategy that I hope he'll figure out how to implement. So those are two examples of cases where you might not get your dream from the get-go, but you have to hold on to your dream. And my dad was happy in the end. So I mean, many years later, when he was kind of semi-trying to retire, he had two telescopes. Okay, he loved astronomy. And I had literally just got my job at MIT when he was diagnosed with cancer. And he only had a few months to live. But he finally understood I made it. Because even if you don't know what an astronomer does for a job, most educated people in the world, they have heard of MIT. And he was really happy. And I'm glad he got to realize that I succeeded and could support myself.
I think it must have been a relief after so many years having a support at the end.
But I think he always loved me. Well, I hope he realized that raising someone to be an independent thinker can backfire on you as a parent. But in the old days, and my dad was a doctor, but in his family, he didn't have a choice. He literally, it's a good job, but he had no choice, you know? And I think you know a lot of people like that. They had no choice. A lot of my friends growing up, or I grew up in Canada and Toronto, we just say everyone's an immigrant, either you or your parents, grandparents at the latest. But all of my friends who had moved to Canada as a child from another country, they still were really in that culture where they kind of had to do what their parents said because their parents gave up their whole life to like move to Canada so their kid could have a better life. And they had big expectations. Like one of my friends at the time had to be a dentist, but it was really hard. He couldn't get into dental school. But that was like the job the parents had chose. But he finally did get in, but it was tough.
So if we move back a little bit about the work you do and talk a little bit about Venus. So Venus is the last place one would imagine there to be life. However, you've been at the forefront of research investigating the possibility of life in the clouds of Venus. So could you elaborate on the specific signs you're investigating that might indicate the presence of life there?
I can, but first let me give you some background. Venus, as most of you have heard about, is a very hot planet. It has a massive atmosphere and a massive carbon dioxide atmosphere, so it has a huge greenhouse effect, making the surface 700 Kelvin and too hot for any solvent for life, or at least any life as far as we understand. But just like on Earth, if you climb up a mountain, or you see those pictures of people on Mount Everest, or if you ever get to go in an airplane and see the outside temperature, it gets colder and colder as you go above the surface of Earth. That is also true on Venus. So far above the surface of Venus, in the clouds, 50 kilometers above the surface, it's actually the right temperature for life. And so half a century ago, Carl Sagan suggested maybe there's life on Venus in the clouds, floating around, little, simple, single-celled bacteria. And we have life on Earth in our clouds. Bacteria is temporarily swept up, stays in the clouds for a short time, gets rained out. But we don't think Carl Sagan and others knew that the Venus clouds are not made of water. Water is very friendly. You can spill it on yourself and we're actually made of water. We humans are like water carriers. But these clouds are made of acid, sulfuric acid. Now, I'm guessing wherever anyone listening to this lives, I'm guessing that you're not allowed to use sulfuric acid at home or school. If you're an adult, you can't really get it. You can't really get your hands on it, actually. So no matter who you are, it's so dangerous. It's like forbidden. Well, so dangerous, it kills all of our life. It destroys life. It'll burn a hole in your clothes like before you can blink an eye, and in your skin as well. So there's no possible way our life could survive in sulfuric acid. But lately, we've been doing experiments in sulfuric acid. Because of the way that sulfuric acid is so dangerous, planetary scientists have just assumed that there's no interesting chemistry, or sulfuric acid is essentially sterile to any interesting chemistry. But we've started to find otherwise. And the simplest one I can explain is we took our amino acids. So we just bought like the pack of 20 biogenic amino acids. We put them in sulfuric acid, and they are all stable. These important biological molecules are not destroyed by sulfuric acid. Some of them are chemically modified, but they're not destroyed. And I have a list of like probably 5 or 10 things like that. What we're trying to suggest, it's a radical idea that sulfuric acid, this chemical that you're not allowed to get or touch or use unless it's an industry or something special, this very toxic, destructive chemical might itself be a solvent for life, a very different kind of life than our life.
In a way, we are molded to think a little differently about life. And I think that changes completely. And then if we do end up finding life, we'll be so close to home and in a very different chemistry than what we see on Earth.
Very different. And part of the argument, by the way, again, it's like this risk-taking desire to explore. Part of it is what you said. Our Venus is so close. Like, why wouldn't we check it out? Like, would you hate to have missed that? Like, when it's so right next door? So, wow. I mean, we're doing all of these experiments to motivate us to go back to Venus, send missions to Venus to specifically look for signs of life or life itself, a topic that's really too taboo for most people. It's what we call the giggle factor. I mean, you brought it up, right? You didn't laugh, but it's when I would, let's say I just met you and you were a student of mine and I'm like, hey, yeah, we're looking for life on Venus in sulfuric acid. And if you start laughing, it's just, wow, it's too crazy. And so most people just think it's like, wow, like too crazy. And so large government agencies like NASA and European Space Agency, in my opinion, they can't back this because it's just too out there. So we actually are trying to get like largely privately funded missions, small focus missions to go back to Venus to search for. So all this chemistry in the lab, it started out to support that, to demonstrate that some biological molecules are stable in sulfuric acid and to kind of make this case that life could be in sulfuric acid. But it actually is all originally to support the missions.
You know, you need a lot of backing to convince for funding for missions to send it to Venus. And I think it shows how much there's ignorance in certain aspects, in a way, something that's so close to home. We've ignored, however, looking so far beyond. So if we do find life on Venus, could it have any implications for the way we search for life outside Earth?
Well, I will say yes and no. No, because when we're searching for life beyond our solar system, we're limited to searching for what we call biosignature gases and atmospheres. So on our own planet Earth, it is filled with oxygen to 20% by volume. You know, we need oxygen to survive. But without life, without plants and photosynthetic bacteria, there would virtually be no oxygen in our atmosphere. So if there are intelligent aliens looking back at our Earth, they really might suspect there's life here. Not because of large structures like the Great Wall of China, not because of pollution or city lights, but because of oxygen in our Earth's atmosphere. It's so reactive, it shouldn't be there unless it's continually produced. So I really hope they're out there. So we're limited to looking for gases in atmospheres far away. But if you think about that, we're looking for like a gas that doesn't belong, that's way out of equilibrium with the context of its environment and other gases. But if you think about that, we can't really map that back to a kind of life. So if there is life on Venus surviving in sulfuric acid, it's likely producing waste gases as well. But we can't map on this kind of gas is produced by this kind of life, and this kind of life lives in this kind of liquid. Like that's way beyond something that we can conceivably do right now. But if there is life on Venus, it will certainly expand and support the notion that a wide variety of exoplanets might host life. So it could be really helpful.
So in a way, if we do find life, would that have an effect on the biosignatures we search for in other exoplanets?
No, I mean, I wish they were more related than they are. I want you to think for a moment of a really extreme place on Earth, like deep in the ocean where it's very cold, inside a rock, maybe in a desert somewhere. There's life there. But it's eking out an existence, barely. So it's not reproducing very often. It's not metabolizing a lot. And it would only be producing like barely any gas at all that probably wouldn't accumulate. So if there's life on Venus, it's like that. Because we don't see any, well, at least we don't see any gases like oxygen, 20% in our atmosphere, huge, you know? We can talk about some signs, gases that might be signs of life on Venus, but on the whole, if there is life there, it's not producing very much because it's nutrient starved. It's like the desert or like, we're, you know, harsh environments with very little nutrients. So the life is just really not doing a whole lot. I mean, that's a picture we have in our mind. But we're thinking of a planet teeming with life, producing a lot of excess gas that really can accumulate. So in some ways, they are related at the fundamental level, but at a practical level of what we would see, it's not really related.
So you talked a bit about how private missions and play a very integral role in the way we search for life or even other missions in astrophysics. So given your involvement in diverse space missions like TESS, Asteria, and Starshade, how do you perceive the evolving landscape of public and private partnerships shaping the future of space missions?
Well, right now, when I think hard about it, I actually can't think of any private space mission that's gone so far. Now, there have been private astronauts, right, going to space station, SpaceX, Blue Origin. But in terms of planetary space missions, at least right now, like there's no profit here. So it's really any private money is like basically a donation to sponsored Curiosity. So we are trying to change that. And the way we're trying to do that is by having very small, cheap, focused missions. And we're also trying to ride a wave of just incredibly exciting things that are happening, largely in the USA. You may read about going back to the moon. Well, it's not just the government going back to the moon. They're supporting small companies. And companies are trying to make like a whole space economy, where there'd be like refueling stations. Businesses are going to low Earth orbit, doing some kind of like drug discovery. So we're not there yet, but there's a strong possibility that this whole new space economy will emerge. And we're trying to ride that wave. They say all ships rise with the rising tide. Like these launches to space with reusable rockets have brought costs of launch down. And we're hoping that all of this lowers cost. And there's another thing too. Some people think it's good, some people think it's bad, but extremely wealthy individuals, you know, accumulate a lot of wealth, and some of them do really believe in space exploration. But is that kind of fair that a few super rich people can direct how we're going? I mean, I'm not here to judge or philosophize, but we're definitely trying to ride all of those waves and make this happen.
I think you brought up a fair point in a way. Who is it that gets to decide? Where is it that human curiosity leads? Is it scientists as a whole, or is it the people who have the resources to make it possible?
Mm-hmm. And we're hoping to bring the world together here. We have partners in like Switzerland, Finland, a lot of countries that whose governments could contribute if they believe in the search for life on Venus or signs of life on Venus by, you know, having instruments and like an international consortium. India has done a fantastic job of getting to Mars, and we're hoping that they're going to make it back to Venus as well. So it could be that we partner with countries all around the world. We also have private money. So I try to call it a private-public partnership so we can have some of both.
True. It's the mixture that matters to get the success that we need. So having dedicated over 3 decades to astrophysics, you've witnessed remarkable advancements in technology and the evolution of scientific methodologies. So how do you think the way we conduct science has transformed over the years?
Well, there's one major thing that has happened, and that is what we call big data. So we will call you a digital native. Like, do you remember a time without computers? Okay, so it's a very different world, you know, back to before. Like, the majority of science would have been done like experiments, pencil and paper, semi-analytic. You'd write equations down, then program in your computer. And there were big computer simulations as well. But now a larger and larger fraction of science is big data. Like before, to solve a disease and find the gene, people would spend years, decades researching genes, researching families to find some, you know, the common thread. But now people just throw all the data in a computer. In astronomy, you know, the mission test you mentioned, it's looking at a large part of the sky. It's looking at 20,000 stars a month, but actually a million if you want to go down to the faintest limit, a million stars a month. And you think of the Hubble Deep Field, and there's the new Vera Rubin Observatory that's coming online, and the big data. So tons of data, computer programming, surveys, mining data. That is a massive change in so many fields of science, including astronomy.
I think we have a lot more knowledge in a way that we're able to harness through this huge amount of data that we're getting through all these missions. As you said, it has truly changed the way we do science. So, reflecting on your numerous achievements throughout your career, what would you say is your recipe for success?
Well, the first thing is to find something you love doing that you're also good at. That's not necessarily something you study in high school or even undergraduate. Sometimes you have to wait and find what that is till a bit later. That's the first thing. And based on our conversation, let's add that also pays. So something you love doing that you're also good at where you can earn an income. The second thing is grit and persistence are incredibly important. You know, if you believe in your idea and it's very solid, you have to find a way to stick with it. And part of that involves a workaround. If you get an obstacle, you have to just find a way around it. The third thing is you need to build confidence. There's just so many things around us that chip away every day at our confidence. But you've really got to find a way to build that confidence to make sure you can reach your goals.
I think that's very important advice, not just someone who wants to go into science, but anywhere who wants to do anything in a way. As you said, the key ingredients you need to believe in yourself. And very important thing, which I think you talk a lot about, is doing something you love and doing something you're really good at, which I think are two very important factors to keep in mind.
One of my colleagues, who's a very successful astronomer, and he's a director of an observatory, and he's very good at his job. He's very good with telescopes and making observing programs. Well, I discovered that although he was very good at math in high school, when he became an undergraduate student, he was very bad at math. Or rather, everyone around him was better. And so for a lot of people, this would have chipped away at your confidence, and you might have even dropped out. And in the place he went to university, if you failed a class, you had to take it again. And he told me that not for a good number of math classes, he had to take them twice, three times. And he still stuck with it. His grit, perseverance, and his confidence that although he didn't have to be confident that he was good at math, because by then he knew he was not that great at it, but his confidence that he was good in other areas of astronomy and that he could persevere, take that class, those classes three separate times and get to his goal.
That's a very interesting story. I mean, there's so many things that get thrown at you. There's so many setbacks that you face. And talking a bit about you, what do you think is one of the most major scientific setbacks that you have faced? And how is it that you grew from that experience?
Well, I did have a pretty serious setback at one point where we have so many exoplanets, thousands and thousands of them. But remember, when I started out, we had very few, zero, and then we had a few, and then we had 10, and then 30. Well, these planets at the time were only seen indirectly. They were found because the planet and star orbits the common center of mass. And we can measure the star's wobble by its line of sight velocity. And so this is kind of interesting because so the star is wobbling because there's a planet around it. And that's why people didn't believe it. It was a bit sketchy. But what we were waiting for was some systems, they're lined up just so. So the planet actually goes in front of the star as seen from our viewpoint. And we call those transiting planets. But there are a lot, you know, the systems are all random. So we were waiting for enough planets so one would happen to show transits. And that happened, and that was exciting. Then me and the community wanted to find transiting planets. So instead of looking at one star at a time to measure its wobble, to find the presence of a planet, and then wait to find one that was transiting, we wanted to find the transiting ones. But transiting planets are rare. If a planet's close to the star, it's 1 in 10. If it's far from the star, it's like 1 in 200. So you have to look at a lot of stars. And you'd have a ground-based survey, and you'd want to look at like tens of thousands of stars at a given time. So I was a young, newly minted PhD, and I started to work on this ambitious project to be the first ever to find a planet with the new method, the transit method. And I got together with a friend. Her name was Gabriella. Well, we met, we were both young, and we were working together. And we made this whole complicated experiment. And we got telescope time, which was amazing. We got like 3 weeks of time on two separate telescopes, which for young people was insanely unheard of. Only that's so much time, but they gave us bad time. Like in Chile, where there's dark skies. If you're in the northern hemisphere, let's see, our summer is their winter because they're in another hemisphere. Yeah, so they gave us 3 weeks of time in their winter, which is also their rainy season, even though it's a desert. So a lot of our time got rained out, which is unheard of. But all these really dry river valleys got full. So that was a bit of a setback, but there was a worse setback. At my friend's university, there was an older professor, and he asked her so many technical details about the project all summer long. And she told it to him. And he never told us that he was working on the exact same project competing. Now, this older, brilliant professor, he didn't need to have two younger people. Like, he didn't need to know like our stuff. And maybe I'm putting myself down here, but surely all the brilliant things we thought of, he also already thought of, right? But this was a major setback, and Gabriella got really depressed about this. She couldn't work for a while, like she got so upset, and she dropped the project. And this was a major setback because some skills she brought to the table, I didn't have those skills. And we should have had a planet in there. We made a few mistakes in the way we set up our experiment. So our experiment ended up failing. And this was crushing for me because so ambitious, so excited, love competition, I love competing. And now the project was over because she had to drop out because she got really upset about this. And there's a little technicality here, which if you find what you think is a transiting planet, you see it transit once and twice. In the way we set up our experiment, we had to do the follow-up method. It's a little complicated, but we saw the transit, but we had to confirm it's a planet by looking at a different technique, the wobble technique. But we couldn't wait till the next year because if you see it twice and your data is just good but not fantastic, the timing's not good enough. Like if you have a transit and it's transiting every 4 days, by the next year, so many transits have happened, you're going to lose the prediction ability to know exactly when it transits. It's just like if you have two transits back to back, phase is not precise enough to be able to predict. So long story short, we had to get it all done right away, find the planets in the summer, get the telescope time for the follow-up in the fall. And we had all that. But because she dropped out, we couldn't just pick it up later because our planet candidates, they would kind of be lost in terms of the predictability of when to observe with the follow-up. Anyway, I learned a lot of lessons here. One lesson is I learned to pick my collaborators more carefully. So if you, let's say you were my peer, an astronomer in India, and you're like, let's work on this, I'd be like, maybe not. We have to get to know you and judge your character better. The second thing I learned, although I've gone back on this in recent years, was I don't do a project unless I can do every part of the project. So if I was working with you and you drop out, okay, that's bad news, but I can still drop my stuff and pick up your part of the project. Okay, that wasn't really sustainable, but picking a good partner, one I can trust, and being able to pick up a project that I could do it all in case someone fails to get their job done, those were really important things as well. And the other really big thing I learned was this project, this experiment, it's like a layer cake. Every layer has to be right or the whole thing's going to fall apart. And so I learned experimental design. I had to do a much better job. So I'd say that was a pretty big setback, but I also learned a lot from it.
I think it was a very important lesson, so in a way, being very careful with the person you choose to work with, because that can make or break your project. And I think there's a lot of collaboration that's involved in science, so it becomes increasingly important to be very careful with who is
it does, And I think you already see this at your level because you have to do group projects at school, and sometimes you might be assigned a group and maybe you end up having to do all the work. But okay, I mean, the stakes might not have been that high. Unless you get a bad grade, it's pretty awful. But, you know, I'm just saying, like, that's, a kind of grown-up situation like that when and you actually got to pick your partner, but it just didn't work out that well. But the project has a happy ending. Because we saw something really weird in the data, and Gabrielle and I worked on this, and we were scribbling math literally at midnight on a Saturday, and we burst out laughing because we discovered something so amazing that, you know, the planet transit light curve alone can actually, it can tell you the density of the star. It makes no sense at all, but we found this really cool thing that just from a really good transit planet transit light curve, you can tell the density of the star. Then when you get the density of the star from more traditional methods, if those two densities don't match up, you have what we call a false positive. And a false positive typically is like an eclipsing binary star that has a very deep transit, but there's another blended star that's contaminating the light, making it appear more shallow. So how it works is that, do you know Kepler's third law, where the period is related to the semi-major axis? Yeah. And that also depends on the mass of the star. So if you get the period, you have something, it actually tells you something about the mass and the semi-major axis of the star. That's one thing. But combined with the transit duration, like the duration of the transit tells you something about the radius of the star and the semi-major axis. So if you have two pieces of information, one about the mass enclosed in a semi-major axis and one about the radius enclosed as a function of the semi-major axis, you can kind of cancel out the semi-major axis. Just end up with some kind of radius and mass, and that gives you the density of the star. It's a lot more complicated, but that's the general picture. Yes, we had a discovery, and at some point I realized that the most important thing to come out of our experiment is actually going to be a theoretical discovery. And we wrote that up, and that's one of my most successful pieces of work, actually, is using this technique of the light curve alone telling you the density of the star, and comparing that density to the traditional measured density. And if those don't match, something's wrong with the light curve and it's probably not a planet.
I know you dumped it down very much, but I mean, you know, it's a very innovative idea of how to get the density and then confirm your candidate.
Really interesting was, and here is really important for people as well, because we talked about big data and we're seeing a generation of scientists who are good with programming, they're good with running big data and tons of models, but sometimes people fail to look at the data carefully. And there's nothing like intuition. So with our project, when we started, we looked at all the data continuously. This, what tipped us off to our discovery was we saw a lot of really weird light curves. Like a light curve is like a box shape. It literally, a planet is crossing the star and it crosses the limb. So there, the star's normal, then it crosses the limb and you get a drop in brightness, then it finishes crossing. But a lot of these light curves were very slow and it made no sense at all, actually. Like something just seemed wrong. Our intuition told us after looking at so many light curves that this was just really weird. That's why we were working through the equations to find out what was going on.
What do you foresee for the future of the field? Are there any potential new methods or technologies on the horizon that could revolutionize our ability to detect exoplanets and characterize their properties?
Yes, definitely. There are at least two new techniques on the horizon. One of them is called gravitational microlensing. Have you heard of that? It's an amazing technique when mass bends space. And so if there's an unseen planet and star moving between us and a background star, the background star will be magnified. And the pattern of magnification depends on if there's a planet or not. Now, there have been a bunch of microlens planet systems discovered. They typically receive a lot of criticism because you'll never see them again. Once they pass by, they're just gone into outer space. You don't see the planet and star. You only see their magnification effect on the background object, right? That's like if you didn't know there was a magnifying glass, but all of a sudden a blade of grass becomes magnified. You're going to guess that something invisible went by that did the magnification. So The planets are gone forever and you can never study them again. But we have a new space telescope that's going to be launched by NASA around 2027 or maybe a bit later, called the Nancy Grace Roman Telescope. It's actually named after what was a little old lady who's sometimes called the grandmother of Hubble. And I knew her because where I had my first professional job, she was really tough. Super smart lady. So she got a space telescope named after her. We just call it Roman for short. Well, the Roman telescope is going to have a microlensing survey. And the great thing about microlensing is it's very sensitive to planets that have a semi-major axis or orbits that most other techniques are not sensitive to. And this is between 1 and 4 astronomical units. So this microlensing survey, it's going to like fill in the census. It's going to give us the best ever definitive picture of what kind of planetary systems are out there and how common are each type of system at the range of 1 to 4 AU primarily. Because right now, the transit method is sensitive to planets close to the star. And we have other methods that are sensitive to planets far from the star. But this middle region, this middle piece of real estate where our Earth lives and Mars and almost Jupiter, it's really hard to probe that region. So microlensing will be a big new thing. And it'll also be a big data thing. So that's something to pay attention to. Beyond that, we are working really hard on direct imaging. That's where we block out the starlight so we can see planets directly. Starshade falls in that category, but it's super hard to do because our Earth is 10 billion times fainter than our sun. And I'm guessing there's nothing you've ever come across where you have to go to 10 decimal places. Like, what's the largest number of decimal places that you have to go to in anything you do? 2?
4.
At school or at home or anywhere?
Yeah.
Like if you have to measure something, let's say you're measuring your room because you're going to get a new rug, but you wouldn't do like 1.00003 meters. You'd say, okay, it's 1.1 meter or 1 meter, right? Yeah. But imagine if you have to go to 10 decimal places, not just in your measurement, but in canceling out the starlight so we can see planets like Earth and Jupiter directly. That's very hard to do, but that's the next big thing.
So by blocking the starlight and learning more about the planets, is it that it's going to be directly imaging it or getting its spectrum to...
Both. If you can get the light from a planet, you can also directly image it. So most conceptualizations of this idea involve getting the spectra. And this is really not... So microlensing is for very distant stars. It's just taking the census. But ultimately, we want to study our nearest neighbors, all the stars that are close to Earth, and know what's out there. What kind of solar systems are there exactly? And direct imaging will let us find the planets and also get their spectra.
I think very interesting new projects that's coming up. And in a way, I think, as you said, a lot of new data, a lot of new knowledge. And do you think this could be one where we do end up finding a planet like ours? In a way, that's what the dream is.
That's the dream, is to find a planet like ours. Yeah. And we're making plans to do that. But this search, this is like a generations long search. So I want you to, for a moment, imagine yourself leading a big space mission out of your home country, or perhaps it's an international consortium, where we may have found some candidates and some slight hints already. But it's really going to take someone from a new generation to really get the job done.
We're planting the seeds right now so our future generations can take advantage of the work that we're doing now.
Exactly.
So a very short last question that I like to ask every single scientist I interview is, what do you think is the best part of being a scientist?
The best part about being a scientist is the joy of discovery and exploration. So it boils down to asking your own questions and finding your own answers.
That's awesome. Thank you so much, Dr. Sara, for the conversation. I learned so much from this, and I think you shared a lot of pieces of advice that applies to everyone beyond someone who's interested in science. And I hope people took away from this conversation as much as I did.